Hi, I'm Genevieve Lipp.
And I'm Drew Hilton.
And we're going to teach you a little bit about programming, which is what we teach at Duke University. Programming has many components. You need to understand the syntax and semantics of a language. You need to understand how to use tools to edit and run code. And most importantly, you need to be able to devise an algorithm. What exactly is an algorithm? It's a concrete set of steps that you can follow to solve the problem you have. There are two things that make finding an algorithm difficult. The first is that computers have no common sense, so you need to be careful to specify exactly the problem you want the computer to solve. The other is finding patterns to generalize your algorithm for any set of input values.
So, how exactly are we going to teach you to devise an algorithm? We're going to teach you an approach that we call the seven steps. The first four of these steps focus on devising the algorithm, the fifth is to turn it into code, and the sixth and seventh are to debug and test your algorithm. The first step of this is to work an example yourself. If you can't do this, then it means that either you don't understand the problem well enough to do it, so you can't write code for it, or that the problem is ill-specified and you need clarity. The second step is to write down exactly what you just did. This is where the fact that computers have no common sense comes into play, and we need to be careful and thoughtful to write down exactly what we did. The third step is to generalize. You've worked one example, but you want this to work for any value of the inputs. This step is hard, so we may need to go do multiple examples to help us find the patterns. In the fourth step, we would test our algorithm to make sure we got it right before we turn it into code in the fifth step. We're going to work through an example of this with these Lego boards. You might wonder why we're using Lego boards and not real programming. This lets us separate the algorithmic part, which we're going to focus on, from the syntax of any particular language.
So here we have five boards. Let's say they're parameterized by n, and they go from n equals 0 to n equals 4. And let's say my task is to devise an algorithm that would allow me, for any given n, to build one of these patterns. Here we've already done step one, work an example yourself. We actually have five worked examples, but if I were solving another problem, such as writing an algorithm to determine if a number is prime, I might start by working out if 9 is prime.
Now that we have at least one worked example, I can do step two, writing down exactly what I did. We'll demonstrate with n equals 3. There's a yellow 2x2 piece from 0, 1 to 1, 2. A red 2x4 piece from 2, 2 to 3, 5. A red 2x2 from 4, 3 to 5, 4. A yellow 2x4 from 6, 4 to 7, 7. A red 2x2 from 8, 5 to 9, 6. A red 2x4 from 10, 6 to 11, 9. And finally, a yellow 2x2 from 12, 7 to 13, 8. Let's see if we have enough information to do step three, where we generalize our pattern. I see a pattern in the size of the blocks. We alternate 2x2 and 2x4. Looking at the x-coordinate of the block placement, I see that we're counting by twos starting at 0. Looking at the y-coordinate where we start, I see that we're counting by ones starting at 1. But what about the y-coordinate where we end? That pattern looks trickier. We go 2, 5, 4, 7, 6. To see what this pattern is, I want to rearrange our table slightly so that we separate out the 2x2 blocks and the 2x4 blocks. We can now see that the y-coordinate where we end is related to the size of the block. A 2x2 ends 1 higher than the start, and a 2x4 ends 3 higher than the start, indicating that we would place the larger blocks vertically.
Now for the color of the blocks. We might think that the pattern is yellow, red, red, and so on, but if we look at some of our other worked examples, we don't always start on a yellow. Looking across the worked examples, I can tell every third block is yellow, but the block color to start is less clear. I always find it a good idea to make a table to help me. Here's our table. For block number 0, we see the pattern is yellow, red, red, yellow, red. For the first block, we see the pattern is no block, red, yellow, red, red, and so on. So there seems to be something going on with the number 3. Every third block is yellow, but it's different for different values of n. Let's call the block number I, and then we can choose the condition when I plus n is an even multiple of 3, use a yellow block.
Now we need to figure out how many blocks we need for each value of n. Let's go back and look at our table and put another row at the bottom where we say how many blocks we need for each value of n. We see that we start with one block when n equals 0, and we increase by 2 as n increases by 1. Therefore, we can come up with the formula that the number of blocks is 2 times n plus 1. Now that we've figured out that pattern, let's write down our generalization. Given a number n, we're going to count from 0 to 2 times n plus 1. We'll call each number that we count I. If I plus n is a multiple of 3, then our color will be yellow. Otherwise, the color will be red. If I is an even multiple of 2, we're going to put a 2 by 2 block at the coordinate 2 times I plus 1. Otherwise, we're going to put a 2 by 4 block at the coordinate 2 times I plus 1. When we're done counting, we'll be done with our pattern.
Step 4 is testing your algorithm on a new set of inputs, so I'm going to test Drew's algorithm for n equals 5. Let's see, start on a red 2 by 2 at 0, 1, and then a yellow 2 by 4 at 3, 3.
That's not what I wanted you to do.
Well, I just placed a yellow 2x4 at the right coordinate.
I meant this way.
Oh, then you need to say that. Computers don't have common sense.
Oh, okay. So let's revise our algorithm and put in those n coordinates that we figured out, and then Genevieve can finish our algorithm successfully.
Okay, I'll follow that algorithm now. Red. Red. Yellow. Red, red, yellow, red, red, yellow. Does that look correct?
It does. You might think, okay, that was great, but how does this relate to code? Well, it turns out that if you can devise this algorithm, you can turn it into code in pretty much any language. These algorithms are actually going to look pretty similar between different languages, whether it's Python, C, or Java, all of these express the same ideas of our algorithm, just with a very specific syntax a computer can understand.
If you notice this pattern immediately, you might think that this example is trivial and that working through the 7 steps is more trouble than it's worth. But when you're trying to solve a problem at the limits of your programming ability, it really is helpful to have a structured set of steps you can follow to find the answer.